Hello. I want to talk to you today about the relationships and sex education which is being introduced into our children's schools. It was going to be introduced this September, but because of COVID-19, it won't be introduced until September 2021. And that leaves us plenty of time to make sure that we get things right. Now, first of all, I'm going to show you the documents which the Department for Education has made available to parents so that they can know a bit about this RSE. It says, for example, your child, this is for primary schools, your child will be taught what a relationship is, what friendship is, what family means, and who can support them. In an age-appropriate way, your child's school will cover how to treat each other with kindness, consideration, and respect. And it says, by the end of primary school, pupils will have been taught content on families and people who care for me, caring friendships, respectful relationships, online relationships, and being safe. So that all sounds really fine. And secondary school sounds great too. They include a few other things like what healthy and unhealthy relationships look like, and they include intimate and sexual relationships, including sexual health. So when you read that, there's really nothing that sort of makes there's nothing to worry you. Another really important aspect is that the schools are required to consult parents. Now, consultation, and that's for both primary and secondary schools, they're supposed to consult parents. Consultation involves seeking the opinion of parents about the sex education proposals in order to better understand their views and taking these views into account when making the final decision. Now, one of the things is that the Department for Education appears to have actually downgraded consultation to engagement. Engagement is about providing formal channels through which parents can express views about certain aspects of the school's work. Nonetheless, in practical terms, parents should be provided with clear information. Parents should be given enough time to consider and respond to that information, and the schools should consider these views. Now, I'm going to read to you a few paragraphs from this document on engagement because, and well, you can see what you think. So it says engagement includes considering whether any strongly held views of the parent body should lead the school to adapt when and how they approach certain topics with their pupils. I find that slightly worrying because it's like when and how rather than whether. So how do we feed into that? And then it goes on to say, effective engagement has an end point at which point plans and policies are decided, and the school explains to parents the conclusions they have reached and the curriculum approach they plan to adopt. Schools should be clear with parents from the outset and throughout that whilst their views are welcome and will be genuinely reflected on to reach their final decisions, they do not amount to a veto over curriculum content. What I'm concerned about, here we go, is that this engagement is actually a cosmetic exercise which doesn't really allow parents to properly influence the relationships and sex education. And this hunch was sort of confirmed when I looked at a guide produced by the Times Education Supplement, a guide for schools. And it's full of sort of platitudes like, the article was called How to Avoid the Parent Trap. And it says things like, allow parents to feel heard and then you've done as much as you can do. If they feel they've been listened to, that's half the battle. And then it says things like organise smaller meetings, because apparently that reduces the chances of sort of conflict, and with the difficult parents, take them to one side. And I also detect a certain contempt for parents in that document, because it says things like the level of prejudice was shocking for those who've not experienced it before. There was no way to reason with the view of some parents. And what I feel is that actually the attitude is all about getting parents onto the school's wavelength. So it says in this guide that engagement helps to develop a shared set of values between the schools and the parents. But I think that shared set of values is about getting parents onto the school's set of values rather than actually going to the parents, finding out what their values and priorities are, and then the school adapting in response to the parents, which really is what it should be about. So I'm a bit sort of suspicious of this whole thing. And what I do want to say is that this contempt for parents, I think, filters down from the highest levels. The Times Educational Supplement actually sort of recruits as an advisor to this article, Sarah Hewitt Clarkson. And she has a school with 96% Muslim children. And without telling the parents, and she's on record in The Guardian as sort of being proud of the fact that she didn't tell parents, didn't consult parents. She taught her pupils about same-sex marriage and same-sex relationships and transgender children. And the parents of her school were upset about this because it was against their Muslim faith. And she had absolute contempt for that. She didn't pay any attention or make any adaptations at all, and actually it resulted in protests, it resulted in a court case, so I don't think she was the best person to consult. Even the chair of the Equality and Human Rights Commission, David Isaacs, has suggested that teachers need not consult parents when introducing LGBT elements into their child's curriculum. And then here's I'm just going to show you this little video of the MP Russell Moyle.
Of course, public opinion in one way, because we as politicians have to recognise public opinion can be whipped up by dangerous forces, and we have a moral responsibility to sometimes make a judgment, not on whether there has been consultation one way or another. This was a totally vacuous argument that had no content to it.
Which I also think kind of reflects a slightly contemptuous attitude towards parents. Now, one of the attitudes that you find expressed in this sort of consultation thing is people say, well, why should we consult parents about RSE? We don't consult parents about maths and geography. But this is a really spurious argument, because the subjects which schools teach, you know, maths, physics, geography, whatever, these are subjects which are equipping children and young people for the knowledge, with the knowledge and skills which they need to go out into the world, get themselves a job, know how to function in the political system and the administrative system. They have a completely different role. If you talk about relationships and sex, this is about how we conduct the most intimate aspects of our personal lives. And I believe this is something which should be taught by families. It shouldn't be taught by schools. And if schools are going to teach it, then they should take their cues from the family. So it's really, it's really spurious to sort of compare, you know, say, why should we consult parents? You should consult parents when it comes to RSE. But the other thing they do, which is really kind of ironic, they go absolutely overboard to consult children, and you can find this in lots of documents. I'm just going to read you a couple of quotes. It says, for example, this is, I think, the Family Planning Association: put young people at the centre of SRE content development and consult them about both creating national guidance and making local policy within schools. Here's another one, Sex Ed Forum. Be relevant and meet the needs of children and young people. Actively involve them as participants, advocates and evaluators in developing good quality provision. And they never turn around and say, well, we don't consult children about what they want to learn in maths and physics, so why are we consulting them in RSE? No, they go overboard to consult them in RSE. And actually, I think that as adults, we, when it comes to relationships and sex education, we do actually have a lot more experience than our children, and we should take the responsible role of guiding our children and possibly even protecting our children, and remembering that young people are not always their best guides and advisors. And I often think of the Thai boys who wanted to go into that cave and got stranded there for a few weeks. They needed an adult to say, that's a really dangerous place to go. Don't go there. I think we as adults should be taking responsibility for guiding our children and not sort of abdicating it, which I feel is what's happening when they consult children about what they want to learn about sex. But the real serious issue here is that there doesn't appear to be a genuine channel for us parents to feed our views across. Yet, both the law and the Department for Education guidance says that education must be age appropriate and have regard for the religious background of pupils and their families. And this is absolutely enshrined in the law, right up to the United Nations. I'm just going to read this to you. The UK law upholds the right of parents to guide the education of their children as fundamental and protected. This is particularly true of educational content which has a moral character. Schools must not undermine the manner in which parents seek to bring up their children. Schools must respect the manner in which parents seek to raise their children in accordance with their own religious or philosophical convictions. And this is actually also spelled out in the United Nations Convention on Rights of the Child, Article 14. And the reason this rule was introduced was because of the disastrous consequences of the Nazis recruiting children. And following on from that, they created laws to make sure that ultimate responsibility lay with parents. So it's a really important issue that we're talking about here. So what I want to ask is, what if you are Christian or Muslim or Jewish or even an atheist, and you firmly believe, for example, that we are all born male and female, or you believe that marriage can only be between a man and a woman, or you believe that sex is best within marriage? What happens to those of us who subscribe to these perfectly valid views? Well, if the schools don't want to listen, you could decide to homeschool your child, or perhaps you could find a different school for your child to go to. Some schools have more robust and healthy attitudes about what they're going to teach your child. Or maybe you could get together with the other parents at the school and say to tell the school that you don't like what's going on. But if you do any of these things, you're going to find yourself being the object of monitoring and investigation and possibly police attention. Because the Department for Education has produced this guidance called Primary School Disruption over LGBT Teaching and Relationships Education. And the Department for Education tells schools to look out for things like more parents asking questions about RSE, parents themselves organising meetings about RSE, parents asking to withdraw their children, the leafleting of houses, WhatsApp groups. And if schools see these things starting to happen, the local authority should step in and first organise meetings and write letters to parents and then see if they can support the school by bringing local community police officers and or police community support officers. I'm not quite sure of the difference, but there seems to be one. They will monitor the media and social media content. It says, if you're aware there's an appetite for protests, engage your community policing colleagues as early as possible to ensure they are aware and can take appropriate action swiftly. And it says things like, you know, if there's more than one school involved, take enforcement action against the parents for unauthorised absence, liaise with the police to understand their plans, to monitor the protests. And they talk about intelligence sharing and all kinds of things. And this is actually, this is very, very serious, because what we're talking about here is parents engaging in the normal democratic processes, which we've always engaged in when we need to bring about social change. I mean, you know, think about the feminists and the suffragettes, or think about any political movement. It involves people getting together, holding meetings, discussing things, and to try to clamp down on absolutely normal democratic processes in this way is really bad. And the other thing is the content of this. We're talking about parents wanting to protect their children. This is why parents will be getting together. We're not even talking about, you know, campaigning to be paid more in our workplace or whatever. We're talking about our family lives, our children. You know, it doesn't affect other people. Why should we not be allowed to seek what's best for our children without having police interference? So I think this is a very, very serious situation. Now I'm going to start looking at some of the material so that you know what I'm talking about. And I want to warn you that some of this material actually made me feel nauseous when I was first reading it. Other organisations have sometimes shown this material and they censor the images before they show it. I'm not going to censor anything because I think, well, if this material triggers you in any way, just think about the impact which is going to have on children. So this is the unexpurgated relationships and sex education material. And remember, you know, yes, I'm afraid us adults do have to look at it because it's our children that we need to protect. Now, the first slide is from a website that was called Respect Yourself. And the website was created by Warwickshire Council, and parents did protest about it. The government did nothing. Quite honestly, they should be doing something about this. And finally, I think it was the Safer Schools Alliance which got the website taken down. There is absolutely, I'm just going to show you one slide from the website. There was lots and lots of other material, and at the bottom of this video I'm going to put links to the material so you can see things for yourself. But this, as you can see from this one image, this material should not be out there available for sort of 13 year olds upwards. It's just not right. And the next thing I want to look at, so the next set of slides are from an organisation called All About Me. That was also Warwickshire Council. It took the threat of legal action from the Christian Institute to have it removed. And so I'm going to read to you. This was for reception. These are teachers' lesson plans for reception. When it comes to naming female genitals, we would like to encourage you to use the term vulva instead of vagina. The vagina is part of the female sexual anatomy and has in the past been used to describe the entire female sexual anatomy. But the outside that we can see is actually the vulva and contains the most pleasurable bits of the sexual anatomy. The vagina is merely the tube tampons fit in and babies come out of. We would like to encourage girls to own their whole sexual anatomy, including their pleasurable parts, rather than reducing it to merely their baby-making body parts. Now, there are two things I just find extraordinary, is how can you reduce our reproductive capacity, our capacity to procreate, to merely their baby-making body parts? You know, women get up in arms. You know, we are able to create new life, and we've got a sex education program that's telling our children that this is absolutely valueless. And equally bad or worse, probably, is what are they talking about, sexual pleasure in a lesson plan for reception aged children? Another lesson plan. This is year two. Now, lots of people like to tickle or stroke themselves as it might feel nice. They might play with their hair, stroke their skin, or they may even touch their private parts. This is really very normal. However, some people may get cross or say it's dirty, especially when you touch your own privates. It is something we should only do when we are alone, perhaps in the bath or shower or bed. It is certainly not polite to do it in the class when everyone is watching. Now, I really don't see any need to talk about this. Why are they discussing this? And for me, this is about sexualizing children. I mean, if you're a child who's never sort of thought about, I don't think any children ever think about doing these things, but this will make you think about it. I'm not saying what children do or don't do, I'm saying what they think about, and I don't think this is something they think about, but this is making them think about it. And I think this is just, again, what is going on? Now, there is one more point I want to make. The All About Me website did get taken down, but All About Me was, it was created by a guy, or the person who was in charge of it was a guy called Johnny Hunt. And before that, Johnny Hunt had been involved in something called Spring Fever. People protested about Spring Fever, so he created All About Me. Now All About Me's been shut down, and he's now got a new organisation called Going Off the Rails. And the point I want to make is, just because something gets taken down, you're getting rid of a symptom, you're not getting rid of the underlying cause. He is still going around the country giving talks about sex education. I think there's one in Manchester. You know, he's training teachers. So, you know, just because stuff gets taken down, it doesn't mean that we've got rid of it. Now, I'm going to show you material which is still available. This first set of images are fairly bland, but I'm going to read what it says underneath and move on to the next set of images. So it says, do 9-year-olds really need to know that? These are the words it says under these slides. Sometimes when a man and woman are making love, the man's penis gets stiff and the woman's vagina gets slippery. Now the woman's vagina can take the man's penis inside it. This is called sexual intercourse. And I just feel this is rather inappropriate for 9-year-old children. And I just want you to bear the following in mind. These are some observations by people who study the psychological impact of these sorts of materials on children, and what they say. I'll put the links to the document at the end. It suffices to know that children mimic the behaviour they observe, or at least the behaviour that is presented to them as normal and appropriate. The outcome of such early exposure to obscene materials is, as any responsible parent or educator knows, confusion and trauma for nearly all children, and a mimicry of its incoherent acts by too many. Anxiety-inducing exposure to premature sex stimuli, too commonly uninvited sexual thoughts, sometimes result in acting out via sexual harassment of other girls and boys. So, you know, as parents, I'd like you to bear in mind, if your young child has ever been accused of sexual harassment, if that's ever happened, please never think that there's anything wrong with your child, or that they are deviant in some way. Instead, what you need to think about and worry about is, what materials were they being exposed to in school? What were the underlying triggers of that behaviour? I think that's what you need to look at if you want to understand why we've increased rates of child-on-child sexual assault. The children are innocent, it's what they're being exposed to. This next picture is pretty harmless. This is just, your children sit in school making Play-Doh penises and vaginas. The organisation is called Sexplain. Their logo is a clitoris. And here is a list of all their supporters and partners. You might like to check if your school is on this list. I expect you thought your child, or hoped your child, was learning more useful things at school, but now you know they were sitting there making Play-Doh penises and vaginas. Brooke is a really well-known organisation. I've been at conferences and heard their director speak in glowing terms about the work they do. So I'm a researcher, I've checked their website, this is their opening page. Now they teach your children, and so I've been looking at their materials, and I found something which is called the pleasure module, and it provides diagrams of genitals. So first of all, what do they say about the vagina? Okay, this is an internal organ like a canal with an external opening on the vulva that leads up to the cervix. Fairly biological and unimaginative, that's all right. let's see what they say about the anus. The anus is the external opening of the rectum. The rectum is the muscular tube that leads from the colon to the anus. The rectum is rich in nerve endings, meaning it can be pleasurable to stimulate. Before trying anal penetration, this is what it says, it can be a good idea to try gently caressing the anus and or inserting a finger into the anus. You could also try caressing the anus with your tongue. This is called rimming. This will help you find out if anal sex is something you might enjoy. And they haven't finished on the anus. Here's some additional information which is provided on the diagram of men's genitals. I'm not going to read it out. I'll let you read it yourselves. But I want you to remember while reading it that what the Department for Education says in its literature on this relationships and sex education, it says, through these subjects, we want to support all young people to be happy, healthy and safe. We want to equip them for adult life and make a positive contribution to society. Now, to me, these diagrams seem to be unambiguously encouraging anal sex. And I want you to draw your attention to the funding sources of Brooke. Brooke is a charity. They have four aims. Here are a couple of their aims. To advocate and campaign for improved health outcomes for young people. Another is to deliver high quality well-being relationships and sexual health services. They get over 3 million from local authorities and they get over 4 million from primary healthcare trusts. Local authorities pay them to carry out their public health responsibilities. And yet it looks as if they're promoting anal sex. And I just want to tell you, because I have not seen this written in any of the relationships and sex education literature I've been looking at, I want to tell you, anal sex is an extremely risky and possibly and dangerous practice. It's not only about risks of infection, there are all kinds of other really unpleasant consequences of practicing anal sex. It's something that should be avoided. Actually, it's pretty bad. I've never seen that written down anywhere. Instead, we have this kind of information that's encouraging it. Ah, the Proud Trust. The Proud Trust has had lots of funding from many different departments of the government, okay? And what we have here, this is an inclusive sexual health toolkit, ages 13 plus. You have to pay £75 for it. Inclusive sexual health toolkit. Session 4 features the dice game, which the class will play sitting in a circle and rolling two inflatable dice. The six-sided dice has a word on each side: vulva, including vagina, penis, anus, mouth, hands and fingers, an object. The aim is to roll the two dice and then the group will discuss what sexual activity is possible using the two words. There's a grid, and then there's a grid, this grid here, to explain the activity. And the teacher's instructed to help the children think about the different things they can do with these two parts of the body together. So, for example, if you get here we've got anus and object. The anus can be pleasured by placing objects next to the anus or inside it. The anus responds to temperature, size and movement changes. It's important that the objects are clean and they must be retrievable. Says the same thing for the vagina, very helpful. Mouth and anus, sometimes called oral sex or rimming. It can be pleasurable for some people giving and receiving oral sex to the anus. You can explore the anus with the tongue and lips by kissing and sucking and licking the area. This is for your children, 13 plus. And then they've got all kinds of extraordinary things. Penises and penises. Apparently you can... Actually, do you know what? I'm not gonna go on because it's I find it too much. Now, maybe you think I'm just being overly selective and cherry picking. So Let's turn to the Department for Education Guidance, you know, where this all comes from, and see what they recommend. Oh, they recommend sex-wise. So let me just have a look at the sex-wise website. This looks okay. Sex-wise is the Family Planning Association. That's an okay organisation. Let's check Sexwise's tweets. Oh, how to sext better than Jeff Bezos. I don't know who he is, but here they'll give you info on how to sext better than Jeff Bezos. Or why putting sweets in your vagina is a terrible idea. Don't tell me your children don't learn useful things at school. Oh, what about this one? What the BDSM community can teach us about consent. As it turns out, kinksters are the ones who have been doing sex right this whole time. This is Sexwise from the government's Department for Education Guidance. Next, I go on to check Sexwise's blogs. Here we go. Can lists make your sex life better? Apparently, sex lists can make your sex life better. So let's click on the link which they provide. What do we see here? These sex lists. What's it say? You can read for yourselves. Bondage, intricate Japanese style, double penetration, fisting, flogging, thumb cuffs, triple penetration. But right at the very end, they do ask about medical conditions and aftercare issues. So we know that they are really concerned and thinking about the well-being of our young people. So I think that's enough for the moment. There are a few closing points that I want to make. I think it's quite likely, if sufficient fuss is made, that this material will be removed from the websites, but I don't really think that's the point. This material is just a symptom. Should people who think that this kind of material is in any way, shape or form should be made accessible to young people, should people who've been responsible for doing this be allowed to have any influence whatsoever on our children's relationships and sex education? And I think the answer is no. This material I've shown you is simply a symptom of a much deeper sickness. And it's the sickness that we need to look at. And that is the thinking and the ideology behind these materials. And that's what I want to look at in the coming series of blogs. And another point I want to make is it's quite possible that this video will be banned from YouTube. I've seen similar sorts of things banned before. So I would encourage you to share this video with as many parents, as quickly as possible before it gets banned. And also I would urge you to check the resources, which I'm going to make available and put the links at the bottom so you can confirm that this is actually what I'm presenting to you. And finally, I'm going to finish up with a video. I found this video, the reference for this video, in a book called Great Relationships and Sex Education. This book is touted as being the book which should be on every sex educator's shelf. It's written by an advisor for the Sex Education Forum, which describes itself as the voice for sex education in England. Her name is Alice Hoyle. And it's also the other co-author is Ester, McGeeney, an advisor for Brooke, also a very mainstream organisation. And the video I'm going to leave you with is recommended for them by them in an activity for 13-year-olds. It's called Write a Song Called An Ode to a Clitoris. And they have to watch this video and then write their own ode. And I want you to remember that the religious background of pupils must be taken into account when planning the teaching. This is material which comes from the really sort of mainstream sex education providers. Please look out for my forthcoming blogs, where we'll look more deeply into the ideologies that are underpinning this material that is being fed to our children against our will. Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed this video and would like to support more of my work, there will be an opportunity to do so, and I'm going to put a GoFundMe page at the end of this video, because a lot of the materials I would like to look at are behind quite a steep paywall. So if you'd like to contribute to the research and enable me to be able to buy some of those materials, I'll be then able to sort of produce more videos so parents can find out what some of the material is out there. So yeah, if you enjoyed it, please feel free to fund me through the GoFundMe page, which is at the bottom. Thank you. The clitoris. Not talk to a friend.